papers to the Health and Wellbeing Board last week, which emphasised the role the fire and rescue service can play, particularly around the points that Councillor Hamrath has made around the safety and well visits. So it extends beyond necessarily home fire safety check. You become eyes and ears for a whole multitude of different matters. And members who are more familiar with our work and who understand that we've got vulnerable persons teams, people who work in prevention, who do that signposting, would go into someone's home, recognise there's more just vulnerabilities than just necessarily the fire, and would refer them into third parties to tackle some of the kind of broader health inequalities or certainly fuel poverty. One thing I would point out though, and it is a concern to me, as I'm sure there is to members, 10 fire deaths across Merseyside is too many, and this year up until this point we only have 5. Okay, so you know, we had 5 2 years ago, that was it, 5. Now we're into what, July? And when we talk about the 10-year view, when you start to look at November, you know, through January, there's probably been the occasions when we would have more fire deaths given people are using the heating in the home. And so that is a concern, and a shared concern of Councillor Hamrathy in regards to obviously fire deaths increase as a result of kind of the cuts kicking in. And I'm not just talking about kicking in across Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority, and so on, more broadly around the local authorities and some of the wide providers of care in the home, because for us, they are our eyes and ears around fire risk as much as we can be their eyes and ears around health inequality and fuel poverty.
And just another quick question. There was one in a caravan that was inside a building, a commercial building. Is this an increasing thing? I happened to see a light on a few months ago. It was a really, really dark caravan in a drive with a light on. To be told that little Jimmy left home and come back again, he's now living in the caravan with mum and dad. Did you get much of that at call out? Because to me, that wouldn't be an emergency call if you didn't think somebody.
Is it an emerging issue? Yes, I think it is an emerging issue, and if you were probably not so much for Merseyside, however, you know, what starts in London certainly kind of filters through the rest of the country. You know, London have had some issues for a number of years now around what they would describe as beds in sheds, and that is individuals who are camped out in someone's back garden. So, you know, the home safety measures might not necessarily be applicable under those circumstances. And even extends into taking over industrial units and putting accommodation in industrial units because of the place of living probably in London to a greater or lesser degree. But we are seeing some examples of that. That individual that you described, and you know, we've classified it as an accidental dwelling, you know, fire, because that, for that individual, that caravan, albeit in an industrial unit, was his home. It would have been incredibly difficult for us as a fire and rescue service to have provided a home fire safety check for that individual, because we would never have known that that was in existence. And that is the way we need to work with kind of more of our partners, share information and target our resources really effectively to address some of those issues. But we are very conscious of that. And other things which are certainly coming to the fore, we can now get people who will live in buildings, relatively low rents, to act as kind of a watch person as well, so they're there for security, but they live there. So you know, it wouldn't be bad if people were living in a school or a church or a fire station even in those circumstances. And again, that's a little bit of an emerging issue for us, something we are aware of, and certainly something we're in dialogue with the local authorities about, because where people are living, it's where they are existing, and we would want to intervene and provide them some advice and guidance around safety in whatever that place looks like.
Thanks
for
that. Agreed
the
recommendations then?
Mm-hmm.
Item 5. Did you say
95 stone? I will make sure, I'll just kind of introduce some of the kind of headlines. This is a follow-up. We do an annual review, and then this is a 10-year review to just give you a little bit more of the kind of context that the fire and rescue services are operating. But what I would just draw your attention to, it's the same things come out over 10 years as they do come over a 12-month period. So people living below, people over 65 years of age are particularly vulnerable, and certainly we would want to focus our preventative work on those particular individuals. Also, again, for those who are wheel members, but certainly from a wheel perspective, strangely, wheel have more fatalities per head of population than any other district across Merseyside, and again, that is will be the focus of our work moving forward as well. Not higher, but rather than going into detail, I think the broad themes are picked up in the annual and 10-year report.
I think that should be shared with the members, especially.
But any comments or questions I'd like to add on the agenda? Thank you.
Agreed
with the recommendation. We move on.
Chair. I'll open the report on item agenda 6. This report is for four members of the formalisation of partnership arrangements enacted under the primary authority scheme with two retail organisations, AS Watson, which have responsibility for Superdrug PLC, Savers Beauty and the Perfume Shop, and Ladbrokes Gaming PLC. Members will recall this is probably not the first report that members have received around the primary authority scheme, but it's just a more detailed report just formalising the process that has been put in place. Recommendations within the report are that members note and understand the advantages of Merseyside Fire Rescue Authority entering into these partnerships. We note that following the general election, the new government have already stated that as a key business objective to take away some of the burdens placed on business. And they are seeking to extend the existing primary authority scheme to incorporate smaller business and approve the principle of seeking additional partnership agreements with other organisations in the resale sector. So, if we went back historically, we previously had something which was a draft cap arrangement, which was retail fire key authority partnership. It wasn't necessarily enforced, it was just a guidance, it was a way of working. Business innovation and skills more recently have sourced fire and rescue services to be more responsible around helping and supporting the development of business rather than necessarily enforcing on each and every occasion. So we're supporting business growth rather than necessarily addressing or preventing that business growth. Frank thought the scheme is a way of doing that, and we provide advice, we provide assured advice in regards to the information that we would provide for the likes of Ladbrokes, because Ladbrokes are big, have shops across the UK. Rather than every fire and rescue service approaching them and auditing their premises, they would come to Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service. We would do that on their behalf. We would look at the number of shops, premises across Merseyside. We would make a number of recommendations. We would provide that assured advice. They would implement that assured advice across their whole stock. That wouldn't necessarily mean a fire rescue service wouldn't visit a lab or premise anywhere in the country, but if they did, they would come back to Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service to seek what assured advice we provided if they found any indiscretions in that respect. And that is just about taking away some of the burden away from business, but also providing something which is more consistent across the UK. Every fire rescue service across the UK will now have, in some way, shape or form, a primary authority scheme set up with a local business. What we have tended to do is manage it in a way where if the head office is in Merseyside, it would be Merseyside that would look after the primary authority scheme being enacted in that way. And that's worked relatively well across the whole UK, and there's a big long list available through the communities of practice, which will identify all those premises which are currently subject to a primary authority scheme. So again, it's around removing some of the burden on business, but it's also around consistency of the fire and rescue service moving forward around our enforcement and our actions in that regard. So, delivery against the RIR advice and decisive support.
I'm just going to ask you that these new partners with our men look better and smell better.
Thank you for that. Any other comments or questions?
I'll take if the answer's no.
This is a new scheme that's sort of fairly new being implemented now. Part of the process for this, I understand, was that there was supposed to be members going to some sort of regional seminar so that, like as chair of the authority, so that they understand the implications of this to the organisation, because there's risks associated with this. And for whatever reason, that insured on that. Obviously, it's going to be self-financed, so it doesn't cost me a fancy, but we can't charge anything above the time and resources that they use. But we need to, I think, the authority or the members need to understand how this works, how it all works in reality. So I just wonder whether if it's maybe useful to have a line of lunch just as a presentation, because this is the first of probably many, I suppose. And it's just a bit of a change direction for the service and the officers. So we need to know how it all is all going away and how it's going to affect the authority.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to comment?
Yeah, just say absolutely. We can do that. We'll fill it into a learning lunch, and the individuals who are leading on this on behalf of the authority will come and present to members, and the nuances now will probably be working at it for maybe the 12 months, so it's the start to kind of get a really good understanding about what the implications are, so they're probably well placed to report that back through a learning lunch.
Yes.
The report says that we formalised the partnership arrangements with S. Watson and Blackbooks Gaming. Item 19, it says that the approximate annual salary costs for one officer can be recovered with four partnerships. So we entered into two partnerships. We're looking for two more.
Some fire and rescue authorities have actively pursued primary authority scheme status to be set up. So to have under those circumstances to recover the cost of that, four partnerships would cover off one officer. That officer who is now currently undertaking those two partnerships that we've described, albeit they are quite extensive, because AS Watson is not just AS Watson, it's super drug and it's others. So it's not kind of getting that balance right. But the other 50%, if you would understand, of his role is back in Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority doing his normal day-to-day role. And what is for us to kind of consider in the broader terms, that is one of our better officers. And I don't mean that to be bad, but it's one of our most qualified, I suppose, is probably the better way to describe it, because they are familiar with the protection requirements, the legislation. They've worked over a period to develop their skills in that. And like you would imagine, every planning authority scheme just takes a little bit of those expertise and that's those skills away from the authority. And so you can all of a sudden be chasing planning authority scheme status and maybe take your eye off the ball around the delivery of all the other implications around managing under legislation around protection. So it's not striking that balance right, really. But is there potential for that individual to take on a couple of additional partnerships? Yeah, absolutely there is. But it's something which we would take a view on about core service delivery around protection activities and things which are primary authority scheme driven. Don't get me wrong, any business that comes to Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service and seeks to primary authority scheme, we would discuss on the field, we would have that debate around how we can deliver a primary authority scheme status for that in that regard. So it's not just taking that balance around where we acquire resources.
Chair, I just wanted to advise members that this applies to local authorities as well, training standards departments, because you may or may not be aware, but only metropolitan fire authorities can deal with fireworks legislation, storage, and in non-metropolitan areas, that is the responsibility of the local authority or the HSE. I think you need to be aware of that, because I know we've had, in the very early days of this, some issues with a trading standards department in a completely different area who was actually giving different advice about fireworks storage than the advice that our officers were giving, and this turned into something of a dispute. It was resolved in the end, but the potential for that, I think, is quite important, and hence all these agreements that need to be put into place and need to tie all the risks and mitigation down, really.
Just to find out to that, and that was the driver for some of this work, because of the perceived inconsistencies across for the trade standards and fire, or the fire and fire, and how we were applying the fire safety order, so that this is to be more consistent in our approaches. And you know, at works and works really effectively. It's just, you know, just to bring it to members' attention, and we will review that and take that back through it through a learning bunch at a future date.
Is it agreed we have? Thank you. Mm-hmm. That's it, it's on to item 7 on the agenda. Something we were talking about at the North West Forum, the sprinklers.
Thanks, Chair. Again, I'll talk through the sprinkler initiative update. Not the importance, because being at the time, previously thought of making the decision about investing some capital funding into the provision of fire suppression across Merseyside at particular target areas, and we bring the report back. The purpose of the report is to inform members on the progress of the initiative to fit sprinklers in purpose-built blocks and flats, and to seek approval from members to extend the scope of the scheme to other premises in Merseyside that houses vulnerable residents. And certainly, building research establishments, the BRE, made some recommendations earlier in the probably 2012, where they recognised that there's some premises where there is a business case for implementing fire suppression and sprinklers in those premises. One was blocks of flats, the other one was nursing homes and premises which housed vulnerable people. The recommendation of the report, therefore, is that members approve the broadening of the scope of the premises that can be supported by a capital funding programme to include other premises that house vulnerable persons, e.g. persons with limited mobility, dementia, mental health issues, or buildings that pose a particular risk to firefighting safety. And again, members will recall there's two parallel elements to the provision of the funds. One was to protect the residents, so the vulnerable individuals, but equally it was about firefighter safety. Now, as part of that work, we looked to work with registered providers, and we started to commence a significant amount of work now with Liverpool Mutual Homes around a premise called Marwood Towers, which those of you know, it's on Scotland Road as you lead up to certainly the Wallasey Tunnel. It's on the kind of the left hand side as you come away from Bootle. Within that premise now, we are looking at implementing or putting in fire suppression, so a sprinkler system. We are also looking at, you know, broader fire risk management measures. So we will have a tannoy system which will operate, and we will be able to communicate to every flat in that block of flats. Now that is very useful around telling residents to stay put under certain circumstances, or telling them to evacuate under other circumstances. And that is not necessarily afforded to every high-rise block of flats across Merseyside. There are also part of that complex 51 supportive living, assisted living accommodation block being built. So again, we'll extend that offer across all of those premises. So we have a real good shining example of the use of fire suppression sprinklers in protecting vulnerable people. The Marwood Towers block is particularly key because the residents will be over 50 years of age, which then fits back in with our, not necessarily 65, but a fair number will be over 65, which again relates to the previous report you've had on fire fatalities, vulnerabilities, and people living alone. But again, a clear focus, as we've done the work, we were getting approaches from not only a variety of different registered providers, particularly St. Helens, who were looking to at the possibilities of putting in sprinkler systems in Peasley Cross Mental Hospital and Helena Housing, you know, now Taurus Housing, for tenants where there was hoarding issues. And again, more latterly, we've had a fire fatality where there's been hoarding related issues, and we have to look at the whole range of measures that we can put in place to protect vulnerable individuals. So, you know, I would be clearly supportive of the definition of fire officer of broadening the scope of the work around fire suppression and sprinklers. And just to kind of conclude that, apart from the recommendations, there is an appendix associated with it, I think page 99. Albeit in black, which says, you know, we are going to use some of the hoardings around the Marwood Tower site to emphasise the importance of sprinkler systems and their broader use across Merseyside to protect vulnerable residents. And again, Chair, I'm happy to take any questions that you have regard.
Any comments or questions?
It's just as
from those of us that really keen within the authority to support sprinkler systems and suppression systems in general. For us to have the mower tower scheme in partnership with LH is a good way forward, and that would hopefully, once it's been completed, be held up as good practice, as well as having a first retrofitted sprinkler system within Merseyside, but also probably in the northwest. Working with LH is good to start, because one of the things that we hope to do is achieve is that get at least one resident social landlord or council owning property, whether it be a nursing home or a residential shelter accommodation or people with HMOs, with vulnerable people, and that we encourage them to fit sprinkler systems, and that's what we should do. That's our job, to prevent fire and prevent the risk of people losing their lives. A bit disappointed with LH about the fact that for them to keep to their side of the bargain is that they should encourage and promote fire safety wherever and where they possibly can. And I know a conversation that we had said that the holdings that we were going to put around the marble towers would have the logo on, would have that sort of fire safety message. Now, I've been past there a few times, and to date I haven't seen anything on there, and that's a bit disappointing. So I'm sure that the DEP can have a conversation, should we say, with MMH to ensure that is put right at the earliest opportunity, but also working with the other RSLs and district councils. When we done held the seminar here, would have been about 2 years ago, yeah. Which was a good interest there by the RSLs, but unfortunately the take-up hasn't been that good. But it's always having to revisit that, because I know we might have had expressions of interest. People look at the financial envelope, and we will give them an offer of trying to match fund any schemes that were going to be presented to us, and we will consider. We've got 200,000 apart. 100,000 is going to be spent on one scheme, so we've got 100,000 left. And I don't know whether that will be committed within this financial year, depending on how quick the schemes will be developed. But I think we need to look at future years' budgets, and finances are difficult for ourselves. But I think it's always one of those things, isn't it? Putting money where your mouth is, about encouraging and promoting protection, and this is the best thing that you can actually do. It's just a shame that the government don't actually see in the same light. Unfortunately, the reluctance to change any legislation is actually appalling. The evidence is there, which has been promoted by all the sprinkler associations and through the all party parliamentary group, and yet the government it's just like sound on deaf ears, type of thing, isn't it? They're just totally ignoring the evidence that is there. And you think that everybody who's campaigned for sprinkler systems has probably got almost 20 years or more, hasn't it?
More than that.
And you think that the evidence is there, to protect life, it does protect property, and it does have an impact on all the other things like the health and the environment and things like that. And it just makes no sense that this government won't sit up and listen to that. And I just wonder what we could do as an authority. So again, we need to ensure that something like this is important, that is kept on the political agenda. And every opportunity we get, we always raise it with civil servants and with the relevant ministers to put our two pence in there. I don't know whether it's worth writing to the relevant minister to say that this is something that we're doing as part of our schemes to encourage the fitness suppression systems. And is that even though we've got very tight financial different financial times ahead of us, would you like to contribute some way to give us some additional money so that we can support future initiatives like this? Because if they're not prepared to change the legislation, then at least give us some money to do.
Yeah, only to say I'll happily write to the Minister on your behalf. I'm happy to express those views. And in regards to the hoarding around the site, if you have really good eyesight, you will see the Merseyside Fire and Shield logo. However, the logo, the kind of the sprinkler saves lives hoarding information isn't there, so I will revisit that with LMH and make sure they address that forthwith.
Thank you, Chair. Under number 9 on page 96 about the housing associations and ISOIs, they're obviously reluctance to install sprinklers. Is this going to be revisited? Because I would have thought that could be something that, or should be something that, at a certain time frame, go back and see whether or not they were prepared or they might have some more money in their budgets. It's such an important issue, especially as we all know here, those especially the councillors. We have a lot of people who in our wards who are in housing associations who are the sorts of people that one would be worried about with a fire risk, vulnerable people, people with social problems, etc. Thank you.
Yes, it's yes. I mean, and what we will utilise is Marlow Towers as the vehicle for that, and that was the view from the outset. From members where we would get something which not only considered the vulnerability of the people who reside in that block of flats, but also firefighter safety, which shouldn't be lost on anyone. We've got a number of instances which have seen the loss of life and loss of life of firefighters dealing with fires in arguably more complex premises because they are off the ground, they're not a normal domestic property. And as a result of that, it was twofold our approach. One is an architect and a firefighter, the other one was encouraging housing providers to recognise the benefits. Mm. What is self-evident in some of the work that we've already undertaken, and clearly this is a driver. We started to identify different ways of building premises which would engineer out some solutions for the RSL. So in effect, we are saving the money in certain aspects of the building because we are putting a sprinkler system in. Mm. So all of a sudden, that starts to become a different conversation. So also we've been able to exemplify that through Marlow Towers and say, by putting the sprinkler system in, okay, it may have cost X, but you haven't had to incur costs for Y, so it starts to make a real strong business case in that respect. So we will, as soon as we've got Marlow Towers, which is in the process now, it's the whole thing, the work has been undertaken, every housing association that we can bring to that location will go around Marlow Towers, and we will celebrate the successes of that work, because it will be extensive, and that is really the focus for the next phase, I suppose, of trying to encourage them to all adopt a similar approach.
Excellent, thank you.
Any other comments? Can I just say, especially to Marianne, we all have, as members, elected members, and in through to our planning committees, and everyone else has on planning committee, it's something that kept referring back and referring back. But sadly, I think there was a retirement village built in Rainhill, and that was going to be one of the first that was actually built with sprinkler systems on them. When the actual build was finished, there was no sprinkler systems, but there was a planning stage. So it doesn't always work. But it's great we are doing this work, because I think we was at the Northwest Forum a few weeks ago, and the chairman from Cumbria raised an issue about what are we doing about sprinklers. Well, we know what we're doing in Merseyside with monies that we've got. It's about seeing that every front we get out and do the same. I am a bit concerned about the St. Helens one because of Helena. Now, obviously, this is now because we've gone in the Golden Gates in Warrington Housing Association, they've merged to make one which is called Taurus now, that money is spent within the Merseyside district and not going into the Cheshire side. And I know I'm being a bit peevish but if Cheshire want to do the work, then we will accept it for Warrington. Yeah.
Absolutely, Chair, you have my reassurance.
Just to make sure. Thanks for that. Is that all agreed then?
Great.
Recommendations agreed. Thank you. Move on to item 8, which is the extra item.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. This report goes into detail around community fire protection 2020 proposals, and it looks at structural changes that will take the authority forward in regard to how it discharges its responsibilities under the protection agenda. The purpose of the report is to request members approve the proposals for structural changes to the function of community fire protection arising from 2020 review. Members will be aware that that's been part of the focus for all functional areas. Just that fire protection is brought to the port because of the structural changes that they are invoking based on member approval. And recommendations that members note the methodology for the 2020 review, note the rationale underpinning the proposals for structural change, and approve the changes detailed within the report. And I just draw members' attention to probably the kind of logic, the rationale on page 4 of the report, which is under the auspices of 2020 review. The proposal was informed by a comprehensive review of the Functional Protection Department, and certain planning assumptions were adopted within that review, and they are listed A to H, but recognising protection remains a core focus and a core function within the authority, understands that the authority will, you know, will continue to shrink as a result of cuts being applied to the service. It identifies that through the review there are succession gaps and how we are able to bring people into the organisation, develop their competencies as we are getting smaller as an organisation. I understand the functionality between prevention, protection and response, them all being in one interrelated aspects of the work that we do. And just as an aside, it also recognises that there's been changes to the competency framework for staff delivered through the Chief Violators Association and the qualifications and competency framework, which we are we are working towards, and part of these changes reflect those changes. We know the key strategic change is probably more financially driven than anything else, but also business safety strategy being part of the work that we do, so being more supportive. The outcomes that we're seeking to achieve are to maintain the competencies of our staff and to ensure that we continue to be able to audit, enforce, prosecute, consult, provide business support and advice, licensed premises and be part of the primary authority scheme. But also, another key output is the safe and effectiveness of our firefighters, so we're ensuring ourselves that the two aspects of the protection function are delivered, safe for relevant persons and safety for firefighters, and that is probably a little bit of the separation that is created from our part of this report, which recognises some of our non-operational staff who are in green book roles, filling some of the primary functions, and our watch managers who have previously provided some of that primary function, having a distinctly different function, which is around operate within a protection environment to interface response and prevention into protection, and also ensure that our site-specific risk information reflects protection-related matters which are built into that business environment. So again, it is about the contribution that those roles will have in firefighter safety, and clearly the massive contribution that the changes will have in relation to preventing fire loss and protecting businesses in the future. The review goes on in page 6 to consider, as you would expect, the limitations of the non-uniform, the Green Book roles within protection and the strengths of those Green Book roles. It also looks at the limitations of the Grey Book roles within protection and the strengths of those Grey Book roles to get the balance right and the structure right, which will allow us to deliver the relevant person, but also deliver in regards to our knowledge and understanding of the business environments. It then suggests proposals which, in the longer term, by certainly 2019, 2020, will deliver in the region of £216,000 worth of savings as we move towards the restructure over that period, but will expand and build on the skills that are held with our staff. So the purpose of the report, or the report proposes that Green Book roles are distinguished specifically on technical expertise and that the roles are tiered in order to create a sustainable structure where the point of entry to full competence in a role can be achieved between 18 months and 2 years. And Grey Book roles are distinguished specifically on operational technical expertise that does not require the same length of technical or same length of development and technical knowledge. But again, it's recognising the skills and strengths of both areas of the service there. The Green Book structure will be aligned to that competency framework that's been introduced nationally, and we will introduce the roles of Fire Safety Advisor, Auditor, Inspector, and Fire Safety Risk Manager. And then we will introduce watch managers who will have a focus on operational aspects of protection, site-specific risk information, risk intelligence, which will be utilised by operational crews, peak orders, inspections, fires in the built environment, training and understanding. So firefighters know what fire safety measures are in place. An example would be a firefighting shaft. They know what a firefighting shaft, what level of protection that would give them. If it's in a block of flats, it means that area is protected. and they would be able to utilise that in their tactics that they would employ to extinguish a fire ultimately. They would also provide tactical advice at sea. We've had examples more recently where we've had fires where there have been some protection matters issues, and the protection officers in Watch Mind Your Road would be brought onto sea to provide that on sea, and they would also provide out of hours provision to if I could have come across some concerns that they would be brought onto that particular scene to be able to advise or take action at that particular moment in time, given any concerns that have been raised. As was said, and the reason for the slightly delayed report coming, this proposal, the whole restructure of protection, has been through the representative bodies, and there were no issues, and the proposal was welcomed by all parties in regards to it being a step forward and it be scalable in relation to how we manage the cook moving forward. There are some staffing implications which are probably detailed, and there are some legal implications, but clearly we need to be able to discharge our responsibilities under the fire safety legislation, and there are some financial drivers to this. Ultimately this is about, in the end, saving some costs to the authority to make up the budget shortfall or the cuts, and it recognises that in the region of £116,000 will be saved as a result of this over a period of years, so by 2020-2021, so it's not just a short-term view, we're taking it to a longer-term view. There are appendices which underpin that. Again, there's two, Appendix B and C are two presentations that have been delivered to our operational crews and through the consultation process, so they have a full understanding of the changes that have been made or are proposed to be made, subject to authority approval. I'll play pause at that point, Chair, and just one final point. So Appendix D is the quality impact assessment, which goes along with the report as well, which again I bring to members' attention. I want to say I'll report if I've got any questions.
Any questions from members? Obviously, there was a presentation at the back here, as Phil said. Maybe that once this is settled down, if agreed here today, that we could come back and look at that presentation and see what changes have been made. It's good news that the representative bodies are fully supportive of this, and it's even better news that there's a saving to the authority. So, is that agreed? It's agreed that we note the first two items, A and B, on the agenda, and approve C on the agenda. Thank you. So that's the end of the agenda for today. Thanks very much. But we all enjoy your very, 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 very short summer break.
Yeah,
well, and hope the sun comes out for you.
Yeah, thank you so much.